Hello, it's John Pollock, and this is Fight News Now. Lots to discuss coming out of UFC 196 from this past Saturday night, where Nate Diaz submitted Conor McGregor, and Miesha Tate is your new women's bantamweight champion. We'll be discussing all of the fallout from that card with John Ramdeen and Robin Black. Plus, we will bring you highlights from the UFC's post-fight press conference on Saturday night, where people had many questions of where everybody goes next coming out of a crazy night in Las Vegas. Here with John Ramdeen and Robin Black as we are coming out of UFC 196, a big card for the UFC, the business for this show, through the roof from all projections going into it and coming out of it. The big fight in the main event, it was Nate Diaz, surprising some, not surprising him, in defeating Conor McGregor in the second round, locking on that rear naked choke. For you guys watching Nate Diaz, certainly lost the first round, but what was the difference in the second round?
What we've seen from Nathan Diaz many times throughout his career, you know, I think when people talk about Diaz, they don't just talk about Nathan, they talk about Nick and Nate, the Diaz brothers. And one of the things that why people talk about them is because they both have toughness, their ability to take damage and walk through the fire, so to speak, never get rattled by anything that happens inside of the cage because they've been there for so long. And that's what it was for Nathan Diaz. He never got stressed out. Well, I imagine it's a stressful situation, so you're going to be as stressed as you're going to be. But he took it in stride, waited for his chance, saw that Conor got tired, and just turned up the heat. And he knew he was going to drown Conor McGregor. Whether the fight went down to the ground or it stayed upright, he was getting the finish, and he could sense it.
You know, when you say saw that Conor got tired, you're actually it's a way that you don't quite give Diaz enough credit. He made that guy
right.
tired. He made him tired by standing there, by taking it, by being tough. McGregor beat all the other guys he beat with movement and mindset. And he slowed down his movement, and he beat him with mindset. And you know, Diaz, man, underestimated that guy one more time. Many people, many of us did, and I think Conor McGregor did. And nobody better ever do that again, because Nate Diaz beat Conor mentally, and then he beat him physically. And that was an incredibly, incredibly impressive thing to see. Like you said, round one started great. If you're Conor McGregor, if you're an Irishman who loves Conor McGregor, or an American, or anyone who loves Conor McGregor, if you're from Stockton and you're a Diaz guy, you weren't worried. You weren't worried, because Diaz wasn't worried. He took whatever Conor had to give him. This was pretty interesting, took Conor down. I don't think I would have expected Conor to be able to get a sweep and end up on top. That was an impressive moment. Conor had many impressive moments in round one, but in round two, he started to slow down. And Diaz, who had said he would come in to kill or be killed, put Conor in kill or be killed mode, and Diaz was in, I'll just wait and kill you mode. He was patient, he was smart. He won that fight, man. He deserves all the credit. That's as clean and honest a win as you can have.
As you look at the performance of Conor McGregor, I mean, I think that there are some that just necessarily tab this as, oh, this guy just took on too much. It was a failure. This guy won the first round. He was doing very well in that second round, and then he tired. That was very obvious in the second round. If you're Conor McGregor, do you look at this from it was the style of Nate Diaz? Do you couple that with the fact that he was coming up in weight? Because he was fighting a guy that typically fights at lightweight, but it was another southpaw he was dealing with and a guy that was able to absorb his strikes that some at featherweight have not been able to.
And I think that's it. I'm sure that has to affect your confidence. When you've been fighting at 145 pounds or 155 pounds, you land your left hand on your opponent's and they crumble. Now you're moving up in a weight class you've never actually fought before. Confident, you land that left hand, and your opponent, not only is he still standing there, he starts moving forward and landing punches on you. I'm sure that's gonna affect the confidence of anybody.
I'll tell you what Conor will be thinking based on my research of how he looks at things, and it's hard to do. It's gonna be very hard for this man to do. It would be hard for anyone to do, but he's gonna go in there and look for everything he did wrong. Oh, the guy, his style was tough? That's my mistake. Oh, he was, I can't knock out a bigger man? That's my mistake for thinking I could. Oh, I slowed down, I got tired? That's my mistake. The only way you really ever truly overcome this, if you're really going to continue this type of going, trying to fly so close to the sun, is you take and accept all responsibility, search for the failures in yourself, and identify them and improve them. If you look at it and go, well, I had an off night, or he caught me with a lucky this, or I underestimated him, I won't next time, you're gonna lose again. Everybody loses, but you want to minimize the likelihood that you're gonna lose. He will take responsibility, and we saw it already at the press conference. He didn't sit up there and say, well, I got screwed, or I got caught, or it could happen. He went and was already looking for explanations of his failures. That's how you're gonna grow. The guy publicly talks about his growth mindset. You're going to have an honest growth mindset. You have to go in and say, I failed miserably. He won. He earned it. He took it. To the spoils go the victor. I lost. How do I improve?
Many athletes that get into this game, they say they want to see what type of person that they are. We heard Connor say, it doesn't matter who's standing across the cage. Now, having this lesson on Saturday night, do you think this will teach him? Are there certain truths that he learned that, you know what? Sometimes when everything else is equal, size does matter. Maybe I can't fight at 170 pounds. Maybe I certainly can't fight a Luke Rockhold, even if I have all these skills.
Well, and that was something we talked about going into it, is you beat Jose Aldo. That is very impressive. And you have to, if you want to look at this fight because you are a Nate Diaz supporter, or maybe you're just a Conor McGregor hater. If you're a Conor McGregor hater, by all means, say this guy's terrible. It was a hype train. It's a joke. Just get your rocks off and do that. But if you're a Nate Diaz supporter, this guy's brilliant, because you want Nate Diaz to have beat a brilliant fighter, had a brilliant moment, overcome real adversity against a tough fighter. If to categorize him as anything less is to do disservice to Nate Diaz's win. But if you just hate Conor McGregor, think what you want. But yes, I think you can look at all those things we said. This guy keeps striving and striving and striving for bigger and bigger things. If you were to fight RDA, if you beat him somehow, then you would have fought, or you fight Nate Diaz if somehow you won. And he was not beating Nate Diaz on Saturday night, but Nate Diaz blows out his knee or slips on a banana peel. Somehow he won. Robbie Lawler's next. You gonna win that somehow? Maybe Lawler slips on a banana peel. Then what's next? It can't go on forever. These dreams of unstoppable growth are beautiful. They inspire you, they drive you. But you also have to temper them with reality. And the reality is, Nate Diaz was too much for Conor McGregor on Saturday night. Now, Conor McGregor retools and searches for improvement. Maybe he can keep growing.
I think that maybe he's going to grow in that certain sense, but in terms of his actual size, do you forecast that featherweight is the best option for Conor McGregor? Not so much the next likely scenario, but all things being equal, is that the weight class that is tailored for Conor McGregor?
Well, I think one of the reasons why he's so dominant is because he does all the work. He sacrifices. He's disciplined to get down to 145 pounds. He said it himself. He said, it's not easy, but you put the work in and you get the job done. And I think, yes, you have a responsibility to go back down, defend your title at 145 pounds, which looks like that's what he's going to be doing. Get a couple of wins there, or when Rafael dos Anjos, when he's ready to go, I think people are still interested in seeing that fight because Conor has been a champion at 155 pounds in the past. So I think that's still a viable option for Conor.
Conor McGregor is a 155-pound fighter.
Yeah.
That's what he is. If he continues to fight at 145 because he has the ability to cut a lot of weight, that's great. You can go and move up and down and take titles. But he has a title in that weight class. He is a 155-pound fighter. And just because a brilliant fighter who had a brilliant fight beat this guy doesn't change the fact that when he's on, his movement, his striking, the left hand, his mentality, all of those things are brilliant. He should pursue chasing the 155-pound belt. But yeah, coming off a loss, I think you got to go in there. The people are going to demand Aldo or Frankie, and I think he got to give it to them. And coming off a loss.
And not only that, he's got to back things up, kind of like what Chris Weidman told us about Anderson Silva. If you want to shut everybody up, you go in there, you take this fight with Jose Aldo, and you smoke Jose Aldo again. And that way, nobody will be able to say that, you know what, Jose Aldo wasn't able to deal with the mental warfare because of this press tour that lasted so long. He's never been in a situation like this before. Well, now, in the second fight, Jose Aldo has been able to deal with everything he's dealt with, dealing with this loss, being embarrassed, or whatever is in his head, come back, face Conor McGregor after seeing that he is a man. And if Conor McGregor happens to beat Jose Aldo, then you have a new story.
The problem is that it would have been great to see this fight when Jose Aldo was 4 years earlier, where he doesn't have neck problems, where he doesn't have rib problems, where he doesn't have a USADA challenge that everybody deals with. He doesn't have rehydration issues that everybody deals with. If we could have
Conor
seen
has
him,
those issues
he does,
too, right?
He does. It's true. You have to. Everybody has to deal with those things. But wouldn't have been great to see Jose Aldo at his best. Jose Aldo can still absolutely win this fight. He's a brilliant fighter. He beat everybody. But where you want to see if Conor McGregor really wants to show what he's capable of when he comes back, Frankie Edgar is the bigger, better test today.
Last thing, let's end on Nate Diaz, because to me, this was the defining fight of his career. I think the Michael Johnson fight.
We said the last two. Like, he's hitting.
No, that's what I'm including. The Michael Johnson fight should have given everyone pause before this fight to realize where Nate Diaz was, because the Dos Anjos fight was arguably the worst we've ever seen him in the UFC. And now these two fights back to back, I think this is going to ultimately define Nate Diaz's career. It opens up doors for him at 170 and 155. And I think that this guy became a big star. He was always had that certain backing, but I think he's on a whole nother level at this point.
I agree with you 100%, and I think the reason why people weren't, or they, I think they are now, but they weren't giving Nate his due is, yes, you saw that fight with Michael Johnson, but that wasn't, nobody was surprised by that, because you look back in his history, it's like, well, we had this fight with Donald Cerrone. This guy brought it to Donald Cerrone. When Nathan Diaz...
You're also talking a difference of 4 years.
I do understand that, but you... When you look at Nathan Diaz, it's...
Everyone believed Nate had declined from that Cerrone fight, and I was surprised in the Michael Johnson fight.
Exactly, but if you look, there's times where Nate didn't look like the Nate, and it's like, okay, this guy is just inconsistent throughout his career. So we expected after a Michael Johnson fight, like, that we saw him, it's like, wow, he looked good. Is he still going to look that good? Or are we going to see Nathan Diaz that isn't on his game? I think now the bar is set so high. And Michael Johnson, Conor McGregor, now everybody expects to see an A1 Nathan Diaz every time he steps in the
cage. He's not the same person because everything he does, every moment that he trains, everything he eats, he's now a guy coming off two brilliant wins, a guy who has pushed through fire, a guy who has accomplished great things. You want to fight RDA again? People will be like, well, what about the leg kicks? Just go find an answer for the leg kicks. There are answers for everything. And when you have the confidence and the belief that Nate Diaz will be swaggering, imagine how good that guy's life is this week right now. Like, imagine how good that guy feels. Millions of dollars in the bank, two huge wins, shut up a whole world of people. And man, it's got to be great being Nate Diaz. I want to see this guy keep continuing. Give him a RDA or
Robbie,
whichever one the guy wants. Let him keep going, man. Let's watch this guy do his thing.
These guys are discussing all of the fallout of UFC 196. You can catch them on 5 Rounds every Monday night at 8 p.m. Eastern.